Conversation with the Candidate continues.
Welcome back to Conversation with the Candidate and tonight's guest, Senator Cory Booker, a candidate for president from New Jersey. Let's jump right in with our New Hampshire town hall voters. We're going to start with Beverly Cotton.
Welcome to New Hampshire.
Beverly's really good to be here, especially the day after Mother's Day with my mom.
Thank you for being here. Yeah. I'm a cancer survivor, and that's quite a pre-existing condition among many others. We know protection for these conditions is very much in peril. If elected, what measures would you see put in place to protect people like me?
Beverly, thank you for your question and for your courage. I know from family members of mine that that's a really tough fight that takes a lot. And I pray that, like my family members, I'm sure you had a lot of people around you to support you through it. I have been offended that we are in a nation, number one, where people who have cancer aren't worrying about battling the disease, but they're also often worrying about just how they're going to pay for all of the incredible costs. That's unconscionable to me. For us to have the most expensive healthcare system on the planet Earth and still have people that worry about accessing care or affording prescription drugs. And that's why I found that the current president and Republicans in Washington's attacks on the Affordable Care Act was unbelievable to me, that they would attack the pre-existing condition, and they're still doing it now through legal means. And so if I'm president of the United States, the first thing I'm going to do is stop the sabotage of the Affordable Care Act and make sure that no family in America who is struggling like my family did with my father's Parkinson's or your family is with the scourge of cancer, that no family is having to worry about affordability or having an insurance company deny you insurance. But I'm going to go further than that. I believe that we need to expand coverage for more Americans. I believe in the United States of America, health care is a right. We can't say we're a nation of life, liberty, and the pursuit of happiness, because essential for life, essential for liberty from fear, essential for the pursuit of happiness is having health care. And so I believe health care for all is something we should have. I believe Medicare for all is the best way to get there, but it's going to be very hard to do that right away. And so when I'm president, I'm not only going to secure the Affordable Care Act, but I'm going to expand coverage by lowering Medicare eligibility so it can go down to 55, more people can get in. I'm going to lower your cancer drug costs by taking on the prescription drug companies and driving down those costs as well. We can do so much better. And the last thing I want to say, it's so important, we need to double down on cancer research and the NIH and making sure that we in America, not other countries, are leading the way for finding a cure to cancer and having breakthroughs in other diseases as well.
Thank you, Beverly.
Next question comes from Joan Wentworth.
Good evening, Senator.
Hi, Joan, how are you?
Good, good. I'm hearing a lot of people, candidates and voters, talking about issues such as immigration, medical care, and gun control. But there's one topic that seems conspicuously absent is any discussion about the annual federal budget deficit, more than doubling since 2015, and once again approaching $1 trillion. Are you at all concerned about this? And as president, how would you approach this issue?
I'm so happy you asked that question, because in this race, I'm a little distinct. I was the mayor of a major American city actually had to run a ship without having to print more money. I actually had to balance budgets. In fact, I joke that there's probably nobody in the United States Senate who had to run something. There are governors there, county executives there, and so forth, that actually had to make the tough calls of cutting government. I had to very painfully, but we had to do it, cut my government 25% while I was mayor. I found ways to create more efficiencies in our government systems. And so having run something, when I get to Washington and see the screwy math that we do, and how this is a president who literally just passed a tax bill that kicked up massive tax breaks for corporations and wealthy folks that blew even bigger holes in our deficit. It's so strange to me that we talk about who is more fiscally responsible, but we see Democratic presidents like Bill Clinton and President Obama who are driving down our annual deficits, and Republicans seem to be blowing bigger holes in them. And really what they're doing is paying for all these things on their credit card, and they're going to charge the interest and the debt is going to be passed on to the next generation. That is unacceptable. We're blowing holes in our deficits for tax breaks for the wealthiest Americans, and guess what we're also doing? We're not taking care of our home. We used to have the best infrastructure on the planet Earth, and now we're about to hand over $2 trillion of infrastructure debt to our kids. So not only are we not paying our bills, but we're not taking care of the kind of investments we used to do to grow an economy that gave more shared wealth to people, like infrastructure and education. And so I'm going to solve that problem. I'm making that commitment to you right now. I'm going to solve it in the way that I used to do math when I was a mayor. And that's kind of real math, not Washington math. And what you do is you have to bring in more revenue. You have to cut more expenses and do things that grow your economy. How will I do that? Number one, I'm going to repeal these toxic Trump tax cuts and have a tax system that works for working Americans and not for the wealthiest of the wealthy, that invests in things, that uses our tax revenues to invest in things that actually do grow our economy, like education and infrastructure. And I'm going to stop the incredible waste that I see in Washington that, to me, makes no sense whatsoever. Let me pick you so you want a couple of my favorites. One is our criminal justice system. We spend billions of dollars locking people up. And remember, if you use your criminal justice system like we do to jail people who are addicted, to jail people who are mentally ill, it is the most expensive way to deal with those issues instead of healthcare and treatment. And it doesn't solve the problems, it makes them worse. That's why we have recidivism rates, 50%, 60%+. And so by doing things the right way, the morally right way, we're gonna shrink our expenditures and elevate human life. And the last example of some savings I'm gonna get you is in the United States military. First of all, when I read the audits of those of our military, it's a tale of horrors. The way we do everything from procurement and the games that are played to jack up our military costs is unacceptable. I'm gonna attack that. And I'm gonna make sure that we're not spending things that we shouldn't be spending. You know, we were refueling the jets and providing the bombs that the Saudis were using to drop on children in Yemen. We need to be responsible fiscally and responsibly morally in the way we do foreign policy in ways that are gonna save Americans money and affirm our values. My grandparents, survivors of the Depression, raised me to say, hey, you've got to be fiscally responsible in your life in order to create more abundance. Discipline creates freedom. We're lacking that in Washington. I'm gonna bring fiscal discipline. I'm gonna invest in our values, grow our economy, and make workers in this country be able to have a better standard of living.
Thank you very much.
Thank you very much.
Thank you, Joan. Next question comes from Elizabeth Radisich.
Hi, good evening.
Good evening.
As a University of Alabama alum and as the wife of a man who won two national championships with Penn State, I think it's really cute you went to Stanford.
I want you to know that that was the worst gut punch I have gotten since I've been campaigning here. We are Pac-10 greats in Stanford. I played tight end. I was an All-American football player. The older I get, the better I was. But all right, roll tide. Roll. Come on.
Oh, now you're talking. So I'm going to have to bring some levity with my question. According to Everytown Research, nearly 2,900 children, which is about how many people died in the World Trade Center, and teens are shot and killed, and nearly 15,600 are shot and injured every year. An estimated 3 million American children witness gun violence every year. I'm the mom of African American children. And firearms are the leading cause of death for black children and teens in the U.S. Yet our gun culture is currently anesthetized to our children dying needlessly. And I say that as a gun owner. As president, how would you awaken our national conscience to this culture of apathy about our kids, our most precious resource, being killed?
So I can't tell you how grateful I am for this question, because I come at this issue in a way that nobody else does in the United States Senate, nobody else does in this presidential race. I live in a majority black and brown community. I live in an inner city. My community is below the poverty line, but yet I've never in my life mistaken wealth with worth. My children are as beautiful as all American children in my neighborhood, in my community. And we deal with this violence, not when there's these horrible, horrible mass shootings, but on a regular basis. Just days ago, there was a shooting in my neighborhood, a couple blocks from where I live, where two young men were shot. Just last year, Shahad Smith was killed with an assault rifle on my block. I can't tell you the gruesome reality of living in a community where you see child after child die and nobody seems to care. And what's worse than that, now that this is waking up as a reality for all Americans, we have Americans slaughtered in a church, nothing changes. Americans killed at a concert, nothing changes. Americans killed at a synagogue, nothing changes. How can we do nothing? In my lifetime, 50 years, We have had more people killed by gun violence in America than every other war in our country's history, from the Revolutionary War now combined. This is a uniquely American problem, and apathy is not enough. I'm tired of thoughts and prayers. In my church, I was taught that faith without works is dead. And so you're right. This happens and is affecting too many Americans. But for Black African-American men and boys, we're 6% of the nation's population, but over 50% of the homicide victims. So as your president, I'm going to bring a fight to this issue like has never been seen before. I'm going to wake up the moral imagination of our country that we should not be a nation with this kind of carnage, that we can do common sense things to make our community safe, and this debate should not be framed by the corporate gun lobby who has twisted and contorted our laws to make us less and less safe. So you want to know how I'm going to raise the moral imagination of this country? I'm coming at it to help our nation understand that we are a nation that when we unify across political divides, when we love all of our children, we act with a more courageous empathy for one another, we can solve problems. It's how we won in the civil rights movement, by expanding people's understanding that we're all in this together and we need to love one another. Well, love is not a sentiment, it's actions. And as your president, I'm taking actions to this issue and we will win.
Thank you.
Thank you, Elizabeth. Next question comes from Richard Bruno.
Richard Bruno.
Yes.
All right.
Yes.
I love your last name.
Thank you.
Yes. And with a last name with a B, you might want to think about running for president. A lot of B's.
Oh, really? Yeah.
A lot of B's.
I never thought of that. Thank you.
Yes.
Maybe you can help me with that.
I will.
Point.
I mean, you know, 2020 doesn't stand advice. For the year of this presidential election. It stands for how many people are running. 2020.
Well, thank you for taking my question. Thank you for being here. I appreciate
it.
My question has to do with campaign finance reform. And it's very concerning to me, I'm sure a lot of people, the influence of money, big money, in how we govern and how it influences our people in government. So I'd like to get your ideas with regard to the changes that you might see that we should make. Citizens United, obviously, is one of those things that I'm very concerned about. So could you give us your ideas on that, please?
Well, first of all, I want to start with what I'm doing now. You can't campaign wrong and think you're going to govern right. And so my mom says, if you want to lead, the best way to lead is not with words, but with example. So I want you to know my campaign takes no corporate PAC money, no federal lobbyist money, no pharma exec money. I think that this dark money is pernicious, and I want to start with myself and setting a standard. What we should all be doing is rejecting that. Number two, he mentioned Citizens United. We all should be offended that we live in a nation where our Supreme Court has basically said, hey, corporations are human beings. Well, I'm sorry. That is just not the case. And to give them the rights that humans have, to say that their speech rights are the same as ours, suddenly it doesn't create equality. It actually creates the suppression of the individual speech rights as these corporations who are amassing extraordinary amounts of money and drowning out our voices, because you all are up here in an early primary state and you see all these ads being run from international corporations who are channeling their money and drowning out the voices of individual citizens. We need to not only end Citizens United, but we need to pass comprehensive campaign finance reform through the United States Congress. I am telling you, I've been now in Washington 5-6 years, and I've seen how the corrupting culture of corporations will spend hundreds of millions of dollars to change little tax laws to get themselves a loophole that will help them over time get billions of dollars. And meanwhile, workers in America, kids in America, who's their advocate? Who's their lobbyist? This has to end. It is anti-democratic. It is corrupting. And as President of the United States, I will fight this issue, because we can work to change a lot of laws, but if we don't change a broken system, then we will never get our democracy back on track, focusing on what matters. Human contact, human connection, not corporations and corporate power. It's about affirming the dignity and the voice of every American. And it's time, there's a saying in African-American communities from a great song, lift every voice and sing. Well, I will bring about a chorus of conviction that will change these laws so that we have a vindication of humans and American citizens in this country again.
Thank you very much. I'll look forward for you to do that.
Thank you,
thanks.
Sir. Thank you.
Thanks, Richard. We have a social media question coming in here from John Mata.
Wait, hold on. Is it coming on Instagram, Twitter, Facebook? Where is it coming from?
They don't specify.
They don't specify.
Somewhere in the ether.
Somewhere
it's
in the ether.
Down.
Okay.
So John Mata asks a labor force question. What is your plan to get more workers help with the critical labor shortage facing our country?
Well, I want to go right at this because the very first piece of legislation I introduced when I was mayor, when I was United States Senator, was on apprenticeship programs. We have a nation right now that's falling behind a lot of our competitors in preparing people for 21st century jobs. My dad used to tease me. He's like, boy, you got a degree in sociology, political science, history. I don't know what you're qualified to do. You got more degrees in the month of July, but you ain't hot. For the 21st century, we need four-year college. It's not always the answer for the jobs that are needed. I love hearing all this conversation about affordable college. I've got a debt-free college plan, but remember, right now, 35% of American kids go to college. I want to see that number get bigger, but I also know that I'll take a kid with a plumbing license over a kid with an art history degree when it comes to jobs that actually are going to pay and give you a good career. But we're falling behind in that preparation. Other nations are doing a better job in helping people get to advanced manufacturing jobs, to become machinists and other jobs that are really good union jobs, benefits and more that give great careers and entree into the middle class. So what I'm committed to is incredible to making us the best nation in America, in the world, for apprenticeship programs, but I also don't want to stop there. I want to make one more really important point. We also have to be a party that begins to talk to people who are feeling that insecurity of the future of work in that it might make their jobs disappear. Yeah, we need to have fair trade laws so American workers don't lose out because of other people suppressing wages in their country and stealing our jobs. I believe in that, but remember, we're losing a lot of work right now because of the microchip of automation. We can see literally 20, 30, 40% of our jobs as we know them right now disappear in my lifetime. How are we preparing people for that? If we're not talking to those people's concerns, for example, I believe we need to deal with the urgency of climate change. But if I'm a coal miner and I look to the Democratic Party and you don't have a vision for me, I'm going to vote for somebody else. And so this is how we're going to deal with this. Other countries have what I call mid-career apprenticeship programs, meaning if your job disappears, you can shift over to another job, have an apprenticeship program where you can learn and earn at the same time, and I'll stop.
Yeah, we've got to continue online and on our mobile app. The conversation will continue. Join us there.
All right, man.
Thank you, Senator.
Thank you so much. All right. Thank you, everybody. Thank you.